It has been a good time of ministry here, and as we get into this transitional month, we continue to look to God, because God is the one who orders our steps. Did you know that? And since he's the one who orders our steps, we go according to his will and to his purpose. For the children of Israel, whenever the cloud would move, you remember when we talked about the pillar of cloud and the pillar of fire? Every time the pillar of cloud would stand, would stop, they knew that was the place to stand and to be able to settle down, and then they would be able to move on only after the cloud would move. At night, it was the pillar of fire. And every time the fire would move, they knew it was time to move. And whenever it stopped, they knew it was time to do what? To stop. And so we are here, and we trust God that as he continues to guide and direct our lives, we will be in his will. Well, today we want to talk about the discipline of fasting. I know there are many of you probably who are aware about prayer and fasting, and you have been exercising this, and we want to encourage you to continue doing so. But I know there are many of you also who need to know and who need to embrace this aspect of our Christian living, and that is fasting. And so, as I said earlier, in case you have not yet come on board and you have just been wondering what is this praying fasting all about, I'm going to bring us some message that will help you appreciate why you need to come on board and be part of this time of prayer and fasting. And so let's go straight away and look at the reading for today. We are going to be looking at the Gospel of Matthew chapter 6 from verse 16 down to verse number 18. Shall we read together? If you can be able to see the screens from whichever angle, let us go. 1, 2. Okay, just a minute. Okay, all right. Chris is a good man. Did you know that? And we are praying for him one of these days also to be remembered by God. Hallelujah. Amen. Yeah, we want to thank God for him, and he helps us to make sure that the message comes to you loud and clear. Amen. Lovely. Okay. So we are looking at the discipline of fasting, and we are looking at the scripture for today, which is Matthew chapter 6, and we are going to do from verse number 16. 1, 2, let's go. When you fast, do not look somber as the hypocrites do, for they disfigure their faces to show men they are fasting. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. Are you getting the potency of this word? As you read it, sometimes God is already speaking to us. He's already helping us appreciate what the ministry is all about. And as we go next, but when you fast, put oil on your head and wash your face, so that it will not be obvious to men that you are doing what? You are fasting, but only to your Father who is unseen, and your Father who sees what is done in the secret will do what? Will reward you. That's what this prayer and fasting is all about. It is not about showing how spiritual we are. It is not about looking down on others because you are not fasting. I am fasting. I'm more spiritual than you. No. It is an exercise, and we are going to see in a short while, which all of us can embrace as believers. And I want to stress that anyone here who is a child of God, you know Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, you can pray and fast. It is not just the pastors. It is not just people who are involved in ministry. Anybody can be able to pray. Why am I saying so? Because Jesus himself prayed and fasted. And normally I like to challenge myself. If there is anything that Jesus did, I want to do it in obedience to him. And that is why when we talk about water baptism, Jesus was baptized so that he can fulfill all righteousness. And if Jesus was baptized, why shouldn't I not be baptized like he was? Jesus waited on the empowerment of the Holy Spirit over his life. And if Jesus needed the power of the Holy Ghost upon his life, how much more me, his own creation, his own child, should I also desire the baptism of the Holy Ghost? So this afternoon, we are going to look at the fact that Jesus prayed with fasting. And he's also asking us, he's admonishing us that we should pray with fasting. When you pray and fast, that is what the message is all about. So fasting is not exemption. There are rules and regulations that govern it in order to achieve its end. We shall be carefully able to consider some of this in our presentation here this afternoon. In his Sermon on the Mount, our Lord Jesus Christ includes the discipline of fasting as the three essential duties or devotions of his followers. Okay? Jesus taught, Jesus emphasized these three essential duties and devotions for all of us who follow him. While giving speaks of our duty to humankind, prayer, our duty to God, fasting in this trilogy seems to address our private world and our inner self. And we are going to be alluding to this as I go on with my sharing. We shall see, as Pastor Grace admonished us last weekend, that we need to give, faithfully our tithes and our offerings. And as I was telling people in the earlier service, one of the things about prayer and fasting is that it is a grace of God. It is an opportunity where you give God to come in and minister to you. It is a door that you open in your life where God can venture into your situation, where God can be manifest in your circumstances. And we are going to look at the fact that as Jesus was ministering with his disciples, one time he met his disciples busy trying to exorcise a demon out of somebody. And they were struggling, trying to exorcise that demon. And then Jesus, looking at the disciples, he told them, this kind, somebody say this kind, cannot come out but by prayer and... Can I challenge you? Could it be that stubbornness that is in your child can only come out when you pray and fast? Could it be that that husband who has left home and has abandoned the home can be brought back home if you, my sister, take time and pray and fast about it? Could it be, my brother, that promotion that some boss has been sitting on all these years can be released if you take time and pray and do what? And fast. There are some demons that don't shake. They don't move until we pray and we fast. And so normally I take it very seriously. Anything that Jesus did, or any command or any persuasion that Jesus gave concerning our Christian commitment and our living, I want to do it. Though the Lord did not command it, he strongly encouraged it in unequivocal terms when he said, when you fast. In other words, he is expecting that for you as a child of God, it should be your normal practice. It should be your traditional thing, that you take time once in a while to pray and fast. For the Pharisees, they used to do it three times in a week. And they also used to give their tithes. And that is why the young man came to Jesus and said, and may I fast three times? I have given my tithes and my offerings. And Jesus told him, it's not about tithes and offerings, it's about relationship. And so in Matthew chapter 4, and also in the Gospel of John chapter 4, we see that Jesus practiced prayer and fasting. He engaged in prayer and fasting. To neglect fasting is to neglect our inner life as Christians and to throw ourselves into imbalance and disorder. Many Christians will be helped if they practiced rightly, not that word, rightly, this discipline of fasting. Because again, there are people, like the Bible says, like the Pharisees, they have this face that looks very, you know, downcast, and they also go at the corners of the streets with their sackcloth so that everybody can see the men, the women of God are praying and fasting. No, 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 no. The Bible says that they have already received the what? Their reward. But if you go into your secret place, I like that word. When you go into your secret place, I don't know whether you have a secret place. You know, for Jacob, it was Peniel, where he would go and seek God. And sometimes God would come and visit with him there and wrestle with him. It is the place where he saw the ladder going up into the heavens and angels descending and ascending. You know, there's a place we call the secret place where we connect with God. Are you getting this thing now? There's a deeper place. There's a deeper place that you can go to as a child of God. Don't be shallow. Don't be contented with the nominal. Don't be complacent about your faith. Sometimes you go deep in the things of God, and the Bible says, deep seeks for the deep. And as you draw near to God, what does he do? He also draws near to God. As you hunger and thirst for his righteousness, then does he also manifest himself to you? It doesn't just happen. And sometimes we have to put aside all these religious, you know, things that we do and take time and have an inner intercourse, an inner place where we engage with God and God engages with us. It is a discipline, and like every other spiritual discipline ordained by God, not by man, it is a means of receiving God's grace. I've already said, just like all the other aspects that we are asked to be disciplined about. If you're disciplined in prayer, God will manifest himself to you. If you're disciplined in fellowship, God will manifest himself to you. If you're disciplined in the area of reading the word of God, God will manifest himself to you. If you're disciplined in the area of also just trusting God through your tithes and your offerings, I'm telling you, God is going to manifest himself to you. So there are certain disciplines that God in his word has asked us to enter into, and when we enter into, he unveils, he opens his grace towards us. He comes to us in a deeper way, and that is what we are going to be looking at in a short while. Every discipline involves learning, mental and moral training, or rather a system of rules for conduct, or a behavior according to certain established rule. Every discipline requires commitment. It requires inner drive. These are not things that just happen. You must deny yourself. You must say, from today, I'm not going to take no food. From today, I'm not going to watch any television. Today, I'm not going to go anywhere pleasure. I just want to stay in my house, in my secret place, and I want to seek God. I want to hear him. I want to feel him in my life. I want to know him in a deep way. That's what we are saying here. And fasting and prayer has that way of helping us. So what is fasting? I'm going to begin by saying what it is not, and then what it is. I want to say it this way, that it is not a hunger strike or health dieting for slimming. My sisters, when you are dieting to slim, to get that figure that you want, that is not fasting. Okay? All right? When you go and you say hakiye tu, and you stand somewhere and you sit there and you say you are not going to eat until haki yako imetimizwa, that is not prayer and fasting. That is hunger strike. Or that is dieting. Secondly, We are saying that it is a deliberate, somebody say deliberate. It's an intentional thing. Your purpose, you persuade yourself to abstain from food and sometimes water for spiritual purposes. So what are the types of fastings that we can engage in as believers? There are three that are there. There could be many others, but these three are the ones that we can allude to. Number one is partial fasting, where you take light meals or fluids only during the day. And sometimes you can do this over a long period of time, particularly those who go for 40 days of fasting or even 21 days of fasting. Like what we are doing here, we are taking 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. And at 6 p.m., you can take a light meal, all right? And you continue on with the fasting. And I'm telling you, the 14 days will pass even without you knowing. You know, we can do without this food. You will not die, my sister. Bwana asifiwe. You will not die, my brother. Yeah, you can make it, you know? And we are going to see in a short while, sometimes we can take either 3 days or you can take even a week. You can take 14 days. You can take 21 days or you can go even 40 days like Jesus did, all right? So there is partial fasting, light meals or fluids, okay? And then there is the normal fast where there is no food but water. And this one you can also do up to 3 days or even 7 days, just taking water and also taking some time to rest in between, but also praying. This is a normal fast which many of us are used to, either 3 days or 7 days, or even just 1 day. You know, you're just fasting for 1 day, you can take the normal fast. The third one is what we refer to as absolute fasting, where there is no food, no water, kneel by mouth. And again, this one we would recommend that you don't go more than 3 days, all right? Because your body system breaks down after 3 days. Unless the Lord has spoken to you in a very special way to go any longer, but usually the 3 day fast is the one that we take as absolute. No food, no water. What is the purpose of fasting? Again, that is something that we want to really look into today. Why are we fasting? Why are we talking about fasting? Why should we stress this thing called fasting? Voluntary fasting should center on who? On God, to glorify God. And since this year, we are about radiating the glory of God. Do you know that one of the ways you can radiate the glory of God in your life, in your family, in your place of work, in your community, is when you take time to pray and fast. That's one of the ways you are going to glorify God. We are going to see in a short while one of the ways you can subject your body. You know, Paul says, I subject my body. It is not just a verb that he's using. No. It is an action. When he subjects his body, he goes into prayer and fasting. And he has to tell his body, no, you cannot go there. You cannot do this. You cannot engage in this. I'm putting you under notice that we are not going to eat. We are not going to drink because I want you to hear the voice of God. In fact, as we shall see later on, when these people were asking for prayer and fasting in the Old Testament, even the animals prayed and fasted. Pastor Okongo, even your dog and your cat, that one you are talking about, it will pray, no, not pray and fast. It will not eat anything. That's how it was, how serious it was in the Old Testament. If you read the Jonah occasion and also the occasion of Esther, everything stopped eating. So, what are the reasons? What is the purpose of prayer and fasting? Number one, fasting as an act of repentance. In Nehemiah chapter 9 and from verse 1 to 3, and then in Joel chapter 1, verse 13 to 14, we see the people praying in the way of asking for forgiveness. For Nehemiah, It was the walls had been broken down. And he goes before God and he cries on behalf of the people and on behalf of himself. And he repents and he takes some time to pray with fasting. In Joel also, Joel is the prophet who rises up and talks about how God will come in the last days upon male and female, slave and free, upon the young and the old. And the young will see visions and the old will be able to dream dreams. And he talks about the need for the people of God to be reawakened and to be revived in their walk with the Lord, because they had moved away from God. They had gone into idolatry, and God, through the prophet, is trying to marshal them back to himself. And so he cries in repentance for God's forgiveness because of their apostasy. Number B, fasting for humbling oneself. And I think this one I would recommend to all of us. According to Ezra chapter 8 and verse 21 to 23, one of the things that I admonish within myself whenever I take time to pray and fast is to humble myself. Sometimes where you bring yourself to know where you are and where God is, and to understand the circumstances and the situations around you are not bent to anybody else other than God himself, who has power and authority over your life. And so when you humble yourself, you are recognizing who God is and why you need to submit to him and allow him to have his way in your life. And then number C, fasting in order to align ourselves to God's purpose. If you read Jonah chapter 3 and chapter 4, you read about Jonah, the servant of God, the prophet of God, who was told to go where? He was told to go to Nineveh, but he decided to go where? To Tarshish. And because of that, what happened? God caused things to happen around him. He was at total unrest. Even in the boat where he was, the thing almost capsized. And the people came to the place where they said, let us throw him off board. And as they threw him off board, there was this big fish that was ready to swallow him. And when he was in the belly of the fish 3 days, that is where this prayer comes from. The prayer of just aligning himself to the will of God and repenting and telling God, you told me to go to Nineveh, but look, now I'm going to Tarshish. I don't know whom I'm speaking to here, but one of the things that we are going to trust God during this season of our prayer and fasting is that some of you are headed to Tarshish. And you're coming with all of your family. You're headed to Tarshish. With the whole of your company, you're headed to Tarshish. And God is telling you, no, 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 no. That is not the way. The way to go is where? Is Nineveh. I don't know whom I'm speaking to, but I sense that during this time is a time of alignment in the purpose of God. Is alignment coming out of the grace of God and back into the grace of God. Coming back to the place where we erect altars again in our homes, where we can pray and we can read the Word of God. Coming back to the place where if we have stopped serving God and we have gone into our business and many other things and we don't do anything for God, God is telling you, my son, my daughter, come back where you used to be. Continue serving me. Continue worshiping me the way you did in the very beginning when you gave your life to me. It's a place of alignment. As you pray and fast, I pray that God will align your life. Somebody say amen. See, we also fast for battle. In 2 Chronicles chapter 20 verse 1 to 30, we read the story of King Jehoshaphat. King Jehoshaphat was the king of Israel, and he was a man after God's heart, you know, and he somehow sought God at a time when the enemy had encamped around him. There were about 3 allied forces that were coming on the nation of Israel. And so the man of God, Jehoshaphat, seeks the face of God. In fact, the Bible says that he inquired of the Lord. I believe there are some of us here who need to inquire of the Lord before you engage in that business, in that project, in that relationship that you're about to go in. He inquired of the Lord, and because he inquired of the Lord, he also took time to humble himself in prayer and in fasting. And when the man of God humbled himself in that way, God came upon him in a very supernatural way. The Bible says that these allied forces that were coming to destroy him, you know, because he inquired of the Lord and the Lord told him, I'm going to give you victory. In fact, the Lord gave him a word and told him, the battle does not belong to you. Oh, can I speak to somebody here? I sense the Lord speaking to somebody here. That battle does not belong to you. Be still and see the salvation of God, my sister. Stop fighting these poles. You know, like I was telling somebody the other day, you know, the story of Isaac. When he would unearth this well, some other fellows would come and do what? They possess it. He goes to another, you know, they come and they possess it. And I'm sensing there could be people like that. You feel frustrated. You are doing your business here. Some other people come and they spoil. You go to this other direction, they come again, they spoil. Let me tell you, there is a Rehoboth that is happening soon. Somebody say hallelujah. The Lord is going to come through for you. And so this man of God, when he had inquired and God had told him, you're going to win the battle because the battle belongs to me, he was told to just be still and stand firm and see the salvation of God. And you know what happened? When the enemy was trying to come against Jehoshaphat, I like this part of the Bible. The Bible says that God laid an ambush. Somebody say ambush. You know what an ambush is? He engaged the enemy. He confused their plans, and they started now fighting one against the other until they consumed each other. They destroyed each other. Can I speak to somebody here this afternoon? I don't know who is plotting against you at that place of work. I don't know which neighbor has got a case upon you concerning your life. I don't know who is sitting on that tender that was supposed to be given to you. I'm here to let you know that the enemy who is against you, he's going to be in confusion. I don't know who has taken your wife where. I'm telling you, they will not be able to sleep in that bed now. There's going to be confusion. I don't know which bar they're in this very moment, drinking whatever they are drinking. I'm telling you, they are going to take that drink and it's going to taste bad. Some of you are not understanding what I'm saying. You don't seem to understand what I'm saying. You see, you guys are just used to coming and being given script. Sometimes it's good to also be radical in your faith and to stand on what the Word of God says. This enemy was going to destroy Jehoshaphat. And I don't know what is there that is coming to destroy you. Maybe there are some people who have thrown some kamote in your home, in your business, so that you can fail. I'm telling you, today, somebody say today, the Lord is going to ambush them and they are going to fight against one another and the Lord is going to grant us victory. Somebody say hallelujah. That is what prayer and fasting is all about. It is fasting for battle. D, fasting also to prepare ourselves to meet with God. How many of you know that meeting with God is not just something you wake up about and you just go into the presence of God? Moses was told, remove your shoes. The ground that you're about to come into is holy ground. And can I encourage somebody here, when we are talking matters spiritual, matters of God, don't come with the leanness. Don't come with a double standard. Come with their knowledge. Come with that reverence that this is the business of God. This is the place of God. I was rebuking some other people who are wedding. And when they were wedding, and I want to encourage some of you who are planning your wedding, please be cautious. And my good friends Titus and Anne here know, we normally give this counsel. Sometimes when we are wedding people, they come to church. They are coming to church. And some two girls have put some slit that is going up to, my goodness me. You come into which church? Which wedding? What happening where? So one of the things I normally do when I prepare people through the premarital counseling, even when they are coming, you saw Mwenda and his good girl, Kendi, how they mounted here. I told them when you're coming in front of there, please make sure you're dressed properly. Huh? Hello? You know, this is the Holy of Holies. Yeah? It's the place where God is revered. Where you're sitting is the presence of God. In the Old Testament, if you dared come recklessly, including even us priests, you do not go into the Holy of Holies if you are not well. Otherwise, they would have to pull you out of there, a dead corpse. There are some two fellows who touched the Ark of the Covenant. You don't touch the glory of God. They were thrown down and they died. What am I trying to say? Just be very careful how you come into the presence of God. Be very careful how you conduct yourself as you worship God. My sisters, I don't want to tell you how long or how high. No, no, no. That is a matter of conviction. I don't want to tell you what you should dress or what you should not dress. It's a matter of conviction. Because you are coming into the presence of God. So I would tell these guys, what is all this now? What is happening here? Are we going to look at the bride or are we going to look at some of these legs that are being exposed here? And then some of the brides, I don't know who told them that the cleavage must be open like this. No, 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 please. Reserve that for that guy when you go into the honeymoon. You are coming into the presence of God. And order must be there. Decency must be there. Sobriety must be there. Preparing to come into the presence of God. That's what Elijah did. And we are going to look at the story of Elijah, because Elijah was a fellow who was downcast. When Jezebel told him that I'm going to have your head off your body by this time tomorrow, the fellow took off and he went into the wilderness. And I was telling people, like the Bible says, Elijah was a man like we are. So he was afraid. He was a servant of God, but he was afraid. He took off. He went into the wilderness. And when he was in the wilderness, I was talking about the four D's, the dangerous, deadly D's, which is when you are of doubt, and then you get to discouragement. Then the next D is you go into depression, and the next D is you want to die. And he told God, you know, I'm the only prophet who's remaining here now. Take my life. There are no others. But God told him, there are how many more? 7,000 prophets that have remained faithful to me. Come up and go and do the work that I still have in store for you. Preparing to meet with God. Fasting also is used to break spiritual interference. Daniel, the man of God, the prophet, the priest, when he went before the Lord and he cried to God, the Bible says for 21 days, this man prayed and fasted. Now on this occasion in chapter 10, you know, it's like God revealed himself to his servant Daniel. And Daniel was asking, how come I've not had a breakthrough? I am praying, but my prayers are bouncing back. Has anybody here prayed and you feel like the prayers are bouncing back? He was told, I heard your prayer from day number, but there is a prince of Persia who has been obstructing, who has been hindering your breakthrough. Could there be a prince of Persia over your home? That's why nobody's getting married. And if they get married, their marriages are not surviving.
Could there be a prince of Persia over that business? You have all the money, but everything you put in, nothing coming out. Could there be a prince of Persia over your life? You want to serve God, but there's always this thing that draws you back and that causes you not to give yourself wholeheartedly to the Lord. There is what we call the prince of Persia. My prayer, people here know there is something we call spiritual mapping. And one of the things that we do before we enter into a place, like now we are about to go to Membley and plant a church there. I want to believe, where are my prayer warriors here now? One of these days we are going to go out there and clear every prince of Persia over Membley. You are not getting me now. Fasting also as a means of building spiritual reserves. Luke chapter 4 and verse 1 to 14, Jesus had to wait on 40 days and 40 nights for that endowment of the Holy Ghost before he could go and do the work of God. He was building his spiritual reserves. Fasting as a ministry to the Lord. If you look Luke chapter 2 and Acts chapter 13, particularly Acts 13, we read about Saul and Barnabas, or Barnabas and Saul, how they had been called out by the brethren and they were prayed for and then they were commissioned and committed to the grace of God. Fasting is a way in which we can prepare for ministry. And I want to ask if there is anyone here who is trusting God to use them, you want to go into full-time ministry, one of the places you should go and spend time in is in the prayer mountain. Because being in ministry is not a walk in the park, my friend. Serving God is not one of those easy things that you can do. It's unfortunate people have commercialized the service of God and people are thinking when you become a pastor, you become a multimillionaire. That is not ministry. They have already received their. Yeah. Ministry is devotion. Ministry is selflessness. Ministry is denying yourself so that you can be used of God in the way he wants it to be done, not on your terms, but his terms. Even Jesus realized it was not about his will, it was about the will of the Father. Fasting also as a feast of joy, gladness, and cheerfulness. Zechariah chapter 8, and from verse 1 to verse number 8, we read about Zechariah, who was able to mount up people, and they came to a place of just praying and fasting. And then that praying and fasting was a feast of joy, a feast of gladness, a feast of, you know, celebration and cheerfulness. So sometimes it is possible to just worship God in that manner. Let's move on. What are the benefits of fasting? After all has been said and done, what are we aiming at? Number one is restoration. Restoration over a period of time. For some of us, after we have fallen off and we need to come back, after we have done what we did not to have done and we want to be restored back to the Lord, praying and fasting is one of those things. You know, David, when he had sinned with Bathsheba, the fellow went on the ground and he lamented. In fact, when the boy who was born out of that union died, the fellow could not eat because he needed to be restored. No wonder when we read in Psalm 51, he says, "Do not cast me away. Do not take your Holy Spirit from me. Renew a right spirit within me." And if you feel that you have failed God, there is a place of restoration. If you feel you have gone the Tarshish direction, God can bring you back to Nineveh. He's a God who restores. The other thing is that there is liberty of spirit. Liberty of spirit means that when you're worshiping God, you're just worshiping in the truth and in the spirit. Like I like the worship this morning, you know, you just let go. You don't care who is where and who is seeing what. You just want to just be in the presence of God. It gives you a certain liberty. Because you see, the Bible says that where the Spirit of God is, there is what? There is liberty. Number three, you also receive guidance from the Holy Spirit. I know there are many of you who are at crossroads. You want to hear the voice of God, whether you should pursue or you should not pursue, whether you should engage or you should not engage, whether you should invest or you should not invest, whether you should do this or the other. And I'm asking us, this is the time during prayer and fasting to get that guidance from God. D, another thing that we benefit from fasting is humbling ourselves before the Lord, which results in grace. I think I had already alluded to that. I don't want to spend much time on that one. James chapter 4, verse 9 to 10. And then lastly there, it also gives us power over evil and demonic powers or forces. Are there things that are terrorizing you? Why are you having those nightmares as a child of God? Why are you fearful about people who have either cursed you or they have put whatever witchcraft under you? Those things should not cause you to fear. When we were at the mountain, one of the people talked about when Paul was on this journey, and they got to a place where as he was going to, I don't know, pick what, then there's a snake that came and wrapped itself around Paul. You remember that scripture in Acts? And the Bible says, Paul did what? Shook off the serpent. Okay? I feel somebody needs to do what? Shake off something. Shake off. Shake off. Tell the devil, you have no part in my marriage. You have no part in my business. You have no part in my health. I'm shaking you off. Somebody say, shake off. Yeah, sometimes it's good to be radical in the faith. Don't play games with the enemy. No, no, no. Just rebuke him and tell him, come here behind me, Satan. Because that's where he belongs. The unction for service. Are there people who want to serve God? The anointing for service comes from God. And he gives us during this time of prayer and fasting. The power over carnality. If you're struggling with some mannerism, with some habits, with some things that are causing you not to serve God diligently, this is the time to break those strongholds. Are you having, there's also physical wellness or well-being. When you pray and fast, you do away with the toxins in your body. You're able to lose all that fat that is in your system. You get well physically. And lastly, coping with crisis. Is there a crisis in your life? Take this week that is remaining to bring that crisis to the Lord in prayer and fasting. Increased concentration and clarity of thought. Sometimes we are too crowded with many things, many suggestions that are coming our way. But when you retreat and you go to the mountain of God, like Elijah did, that is when God spoke to Elijah, the servant of God, and told him, hey man, I've not finished with you yet. And he anointed him again to go and do the work that was still remaining. It is a place of concentration, is a place of clarity. It is a place of deliverance for those who are in bondage. Jonah was delivered. It is a place of divine revelation. Do you want to hear from God? This is it. This is the time during prayer and fasting. What are the dangers to avoid as we pray and fast? As I conclude my message, fasting can be abused. These dangers must be avoided. Ritualism. Ritualism is just doing things out of, you know, mechanical way of doing things. You know, because pastor said we pray and fast, you just pray and fast. No. Asceticism is where some people decide they don't want to be contaminated by the earth and by the people of the earth, so they remove themselves, not to go and pray on the mountain like we do, but they go to live there. And they remove themselves from the rest of the people for the rest of their lives. That is another false fast. Hypocrisy. Like the Pharisees would do. Selfishness, you know, extremism, psychic rupture, and condemning others, etc. These are the dangers that we should avoid during such times. What are the methods of prayer and fasting? The first thing is take time to prepare yourself. as you come into the presence of God, if there are things that you need to realign about your schedule, or some things that you are hoping maybe to travel or something and you can avoid it, those are the things that you do so that you can concentrate on your prayer and fasting. Then the location. Sometimes some of us, if the place that we are staying is too crowded, you can take 3 days and go to Catalonia or go up in the prayer mountain out there in Kikopey, you know. That's where we were with the pastors. Duration, again, as I said, you can take 1 day, you can take 3 days, you can take 7 days, you can take 14 days, you can take 21 days, you can take also 40 days like Jesus himself. And also take time and pray. Don't just, you know, miss food. No. Maybe that time when you are supposed to be eating, why don't you go into your quiet closet place and pray? There are also going to be physical limitations. That is the time when everybody else is calling you. There is a party, and there is I don't know what, and we have I don't know who to go and bury. So you find sometimes there are physical limitations. What are the hazards? Hunger, feelings, those are going to be there, definitely, but you will not die. Weaknesses will be there. Headaches will be there. Bad breath. Oh, some of you need to eat some mint, man. Don't come around us when you're praying and fasting. Put some mint in your mouth and it will clear your odor. And then there is persecution. Sometimes when we are in prayer, that's when the devil wants to stir a storm around us. That's when you are being told, mtoto alianguka. Ati mama amengongesha gari. Ati jirani huko nyumbani alikuwa anachoma shamba yake, moto ikakuja kwa shamba yako. You know, and you are in the middle of prayer and fasting. The devil knows how to disrupt our attention and to cause us not to concentrate, because he knows after you have prayed and fasted, you will have put him in his rightful place. Conclusion, what are we saying? Now that you have known about the joy of fasting, let us practice it so that we can live a victorious and a productive Christian life, not by might, nor by power, but by the Spirit of God. Shall we pray? Not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. This mountain shall be removed. This mountain shall be removed. Together with me, and as we go to the Lord in prayer, I sense there are people who need to come to this altar because there are things that need to be broken in your life. There are decisions that you want to make and you are in confusion. There are issues that you are grappling with and you need the divine intervention of God. As we sing this song one more time, I'm going to invite you to come to this altar. Pastors, elders, and other people, just come so that we can pray for the Lord. Shall we sing it together? Come to the altar. Not by power. Just come. Very quickly.
It's not by power.
Just come. You want to pray with you? If you're there, you need to give your life to Jesus. Just come.
It's not by might,
nor by power.
It's not by power.
Oh yes, but
by my Spirit says the Lord.
This mountain
come shall be removed.
Oh yes, this mountain
shall be removed.
This
spirit sings the Lord.
In the earlier service, when I had already concluded the meeting and people were making their way out, there's some two gentlemen who came and accosted me here at the front. And when I looked at them, I had compassion over them. And they said, "Pastor, pray with us. This drinking, alcohol has destroyed us. In fact, they told me, the wife comes to church here. In fact, she's in one of the ministries. And even mentioned that how this morning she was crying out to God, 'Save the husband, save my son.'" Pastor Munyiri and I had opportunity and privilege to lead them to the Lord and pray with them here at the altar. I don't know who said what to you. I don't know who has taken what that belongs to you. I don't know how many times you have made that application. You have gone for those interviews and nothing seems to be coming out. You have invested your money, but you're not reaping any dividends out of your business. I see a lady here who has come. Maybe this is your 10th year in marriage and you've been waiting for God to bless you with a baby. You know, we have things that we are dealing with. And I'm telling you, people of God, the only way to deal with these issues is when we remove ourselves and we take time to pray and to fast. The Lord is showing me there's somebody here. There's a promotion that has been pending for the last 15 years. You're on the same level. People come and they bypass you. I'm here to let you know that the battle does not belong to you. It belongs to who?
To Jesus.
To God. And He's going to fight for you. He's going to vindicate you. I don't care how much they have been drinking, what time they are coming home in the night. We know one thing, that when we call on our God, He's a God who hears and He's a God who answers prayer. It makes a whole difference. It makes a whole difference, people. We are not wasting time. I was telling people in the early service, at the point where I am in my ministry, in my calling, I don't go by the whims of man. I hear the voice of God and I do according to the voice of God. Hallelujah. Just lift up those two hands. Let's just go before the Lord. Come on now, just call on the Lord right now. Shikaya la ba ba ba, sikaya la. Reba ba 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 ba. Shukuru ba 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 ba, sikaya. Emana kesaya la boria. Rabasata ra ba 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 kata. Oh, oh, oh God. You are able, oh God. We have come to this altar to seek answers, oh God. We have come to this altar, Lord, because we need to hear you, oh Lord. We need to see your hand in our lives, in our marriages, oh God, in our school life, oh Jehovah. We want to hear you, Lord. We want to feel you, Lord. We are tired of complacency. We are tired of mediocrity. We have been on this mountain too long. We want to move. We want to move. We want you to do a new thing in our lives. Sharabarabo Saka. You are able even to do exceedingly abundantly above what we can ask and even imagine, oh Lord. Then you come for your daughter like now. Then you come through for your son. They are pleading you, oh God. They are calling on you, oh Jehovah Master. Come down. Manifest your Shofar. Like you manifested yourself to Elijah, to Nehemiah, to Jehoshaphat, to Paul of old. Come through for us today. We need to hear you, O God. We need to see your hand. Oh God, it cannot be business as usual. You must do something today. You must come today, O God. Ramasaka. In the mighty name of Jesus, the name that is above every other name, the name that restores, the name that restores, the name that revives. Yes, even that marriage, it doesn't matter how dark it is. Lord, we are calling on you today. Come, Lord. Touch that wife in the mighty name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Touch that wayward child that is intoxicated with drugs. Oh, Kaya Mazekerebe. Oh, Mama Rabu Sanderebe Rabakata. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. We are looking to you. We are believing in you, God. Release your grace. Release your power in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Satan, you are a liar. We are not going to stoop down to anything less. Oh, yes. Oh, God. Oh, God. Release your grace right now. Release your masses, oh Jesus. Touch your people, Lord, in the place only you can touch. Father, convict them. Move, oh Father, Lord, in those businesses. Move in those marriages, oh God. Move, oh God, in those relationships. Touch, Lord. Touch, Lord. Touch, Lord. Touch, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And so, Heavenly Father, we want to thank you because at the altar, burdens are lifted off. We want to thank you because of your anointing that is able to break every yoke and that is able to lift off every burden. We want to thank you, Father, because you are our strength and you are our refuge. The ever-present help in the time of trouble. And so, Lord, we are not looking to any other way, but we are fixing our eyes on you, the author and the perfecter of our faith. I pray for my sister, I pray for my brother, whatever need they have brought to this altar, I want to declare and I want to decree that there is breakthrough. In the name of Jesus, we are shaking off. We are shaking off the enemy. We are shaking off that divorce. We are shaking off that failure. We are shaking off that alcoholism. We are shaking off that redundancy. And we pray, oh Master, that you may release, Lord, release today. Favor from above, oh God. Open the windows in heaven, oh Lord.
Jehovah is your name.
Just take over, Lord. Just take over, Master.
Mighty warrior.
Yes.
Great in battle. Jehovah is your name.
Clap offering of praise.